Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm coming back to make a second video tonight. As the Lord had just, when I was trying to make the first one and preparing to make the first one, which I usually don't prepare, you know, in case you didn't notice, you know, I flew as a sister Mary down here in South Carolina. She had told me that, you know, I just flow in a stream of consciousness, which really that's what I try to do, brothers and sisters. I try to hear from the Lord. But the Lord had given me this text, and I was doing what I rarely do. I was reviewing the text before I made the video. And I was just looking. This is an example, you know. I was looking at Joshua in the last video that I just loaded, if you go to my channel. I was looking at Joshua chapter 3 through 5, and I was reading from that text how it is a type of a salvation for the church, and it's also a type of deliverance for Israel, which they were literally taken into the promised land in the text. But at a deeper level, it also represents, you know, Yeshua, the Christ, the Messiah, delivering them, just like Yeshua, the son of Nun, took them into the natural promised land. And when I was reading the first verse, I was looking at all these things, and the Lord was just telling me, look at the text again. I know there's a whole lot more in here that I haven't even seen yet. The Lord said, look at the text again. So I began to read verse 1 of Joshua chapter 3. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan. Okay, there's a city called Shittim. Shittim. And I was like, okay. And I, you know, each verse, and then the Lord is like, the ark is made out of Shittim. You know, a lot of people, you know, you have to read the Bible. You would know these things. You know, lots of times when there's someone that'll message me or make a comment about something, it's because they simply don't know the Bible. They simply haven't read the Bible. The Ark of the Covenant, most people think, you know, about the gold. Brothers and sisters, it is Shittim wood overlaid with gold. So there's all the Ark and all that stuff was made out of wood and then overlaid with gold, brothers and sisters. Now, I mean, I know this because it's in there back in Exodus and all that. You can read about it. You know how they made it in the, back there in the first books of the Bible when they came out of Egypt. And God gave the directions and all the specifications for the tabernacle in the wilderness and all that with all these different layers. There's the gopher hide and whatever and all that, all the different layers. Then you have all these poles, and they're supposed to have a silver, you know, on top, and then a brass base and all this and whatever. And then two strings coming from each one of those poles. That's like a, you know, like a wall around the tabernacle of wilderness. Every one of those things, brothers and sisters, which I studied when I first started the ministry back in 2001, I spent a lot of time studying. I mean, when I first came to the Lord, you know, back to the Lord and started becoming a preacher, you know, the things that the Lord kept showing me was, you know, types of Christ in the Old Testament. So all of that stuff about the tabernacle in the wilderness, every piece refers to Christ. It refers to the gospel. Every little thing. And then also Solomon's temple. All those things all refer to Christ. Everything that happened refers to Christ. As I've made videos about, you know, Abraham took his son. God even says, your only son. Take him to the mountain and sacrifice him there. You know, and I made videos about that. You know, Isaac carried his own wood. Jesus carried the cross. You know, on and on and on. And I just touched on that one if you didn't see the videos. All, every little detail points to Christ. As a matter of fact, Abraham offered Isaac in the exact spot where God offered his only son, Yeshua, Jesus, the Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I want to stick with this message. That's an awesome message. You know, anything about Jesus is awesome. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anything about Jesus is awesome. It's just so simple, but yet complicated for some people. It's all about Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God, it's all about Jesus. People want to get into all the details of this stuff, but you know what? It all goes back to Jesus. Hallelujah. It's all fulfilled in Christ. It's by the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. He's our high priest. In the Old Testament, they had a high priest that could go once a year into the ark. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies was rent from top to bottom. You know, it's like 3 or 4 meters high. You know, and the curtain was like, you know, this thick, you know, whatever it is. I can't remember now, 7 inches thick, whatever it is. So thick curtain. And it was rent from top to bottom, you know, symbolizing God is the one who did it. It was way up there, you know, like 3 or 4 meters or 3 or 4 yards or 5 yards, whatever it is, 6 yards, way up there, way up high, where no one could reach. It was rent from top to bottom. symbolizing that God is the one who tore the veil. As it tells in Hebrew, it tells us in Hebrews, the veil was the flesh of Christ, brothers and sisters. It was the flesh of Christ. So, you know, and I've never thought about what the Lord dropped on me tonight. And I've made these videos about dualities and all these things. God uses dualities, you know, and there's a surface meaning, just like I mentioned in the last video. You got the Bible surface text. Then you got the Bible codes. Okay? And then you've got, when you read the text, there's deeper and deeper meanings. There's deeper meanings. Just like, you know, the light. You know, Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. But he stood in front of that big menorah there, you know, when they were celebrating the festival of lights or Hanukkah, the miracle of the oil, one day's worth of oil lasting 8 days to purify the temple back in the time of the Maccabees. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. So obviously he wasn't referring to the literal light of the menorah. He was referring to, you know, enlightening people's minds and soul with the wisdom and brightness of God, the Shekinah glory of God, in one level, and then opening their minds to have an ear to hear the gospel message and salvation through him. All those different levels, brothers and sisters. Multiple levels. What God does and what the enemy does. So when you look at surface level, like in masonry, that's why in masonry, they have the first degree, second degree, all the way up to the 33rd degree, and then they sit over there. There's supposed to be some other degrees. There's a guy on YouTube who's supposed to be a Christian now, and he has all this. He was a 76th degree, and he had a 99th degree, whatever, all this stuff from Egypt and all that, you know, the mystery religions. It's all the same stuff from Babylon. You know, Babylonian mystery religion, straight from Nimrod, all the same old lies. Garden of Eden, where Satan told Eve, when you eat the fruit, you will not die. You will become a god. You know, and the same old lie permeates through. Same old lie, just packaged in different ways. That's why they call it the New Age. It's really the old age. Same old lies of the devil. God's a liar. God's not who he says he is. Jesus is not the Son of God. You know, the gospel's not true. Same old lies, just packaged in a different way, brothers and sisters. But the duality and the multiple levels and layers of how things work in the kingdom of God, and then the enemy's copying of that. That is the pattern that God uses me in, as I mentioned in the last video. God, since the very beginning of my ministry, has always led me in patterns of types and shadows from what he's doing. And then in 2009, he began to talk to me about the rise of the Antichrist and what the enemy's doing. And that's why I wrote in my book, you know, Final Boarding Call for the Rapture. We're about to depart. Satan's plan for the ages, which is culminating in the rise of the Antichrist. And our last mission, the last mission of the church before the rapture. That's what my videos are focused about. Not about what's happening in the world, even though, you know, sometimes I may touch on that. Okay, we know the world's going to hell in a handbasket. We know the new world order is rising. What do we do about it? What's our mission? What's our last mission? What do we need to do before we depart out of this world? You know, before Jesus departed out of the world, he had the Last Supper. And he instructed his disciples. He made a plan and boom. You know, it was time for his passion. He went through the crucifixion and all that. So we also have to do something before we depart out of this world, brothers and sisters. And that's a whole nother video. That's a call to action, our last mission. Prepare yourselves. Prepare yourself to meet the Lord. Be the bride is the video I just loaded. Yesterday or day before when you see this one. I just loaded a video called, you know, to be part of the bride, you must abide. And we must abide in Christ. Anyway, the ark, brothers and sisters, is made out of wood and then overlaid with gold. All the things they used were wood overlaid with gold, brothers and sisters. Now, what can we look at that and say? We can look at it from all the different directions. Let's look at it as everything represents Christ. Jesus is the ark of our safety. He is the one, you know, that we hide in him, we abide in Christ. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. That's what that ark represents. It represents Christ himself. So, of course, he was a man, shittim wood, something that gets, the flesh of Jesus was able to be whipped and beaten, 39 stripes. He was also crucified, and he literally, you know, he gave up the ghost. His heart broke in the midst of him. You know, and blood and water came out. The heart of Jesus was literally broken. That's why blood and water came out when he was stabbed with a spear. His body died. The shittim wood is corruptible, but yet overlaid with gold. Gold representing incorruptibility, brothers and sisters. So Jesus was God the gold, and the man, wood. Now, brothers and sisters, we can also reverse that and say we as Christians, when we're going to go to heaven, we're in our wooden bodies now. We are in our earthen vessels, the Bible says. We're like a jar of clay, like the singing group, Jars of Clay. That's where they got it from. They're saying they're only in the flesh. They're only in a corruptible body. They're only humans. But yet we will be changed, and God will cover us. Right now, when we got saved and born again, our hearts were covered with gold. We received eternal life the day you got saved. Unlike God, who has no beginning and no end, brothers and sisters, we had a beginning the day you were born. And we were subject unto death, to die. But when we got saved, brothers and sisters, we were given eternal life, not eternal judgment. Now, when people think, you know, hear what I'm saying, it's what the Bible says. Now, you will be alive in hell. But when the Bible talks about life, it's talking about, you know, the goodness of eternal life. You receive eternal life and you will live eternally with life, not death. There's an eternal death for those who are damned to hell, who refuse to receive the grace of God, who refuse to be born again. As Jesus said, John chapter 3, he said, you know, those who do not believe in him, the wrath of God abides on them. It remains on them. That takes me back to what I'm talking about, the ark, brothers and sisters. The ark representing Christ, and then the whole tabernacle in the wilderness and the temple of King Solomon, which was used later, but the same thing, just a double portion. King Solomon's temple was a double portion to the size of the tabernacle wilderness, but basically the same thing, but just a permanent facility. And the tabernacle in the wilderness was a bunch of tents. Was a mobile unit, basically, was they were wandering in the wilderness and all the way until the time when King Solomon built the temple. It went into Shiloh and then from there until they built the temple of King Solomon. Anyway, but so it's about a period of about 500 years, 550 years, the ark was dwelling in this mobile tabernacle in the wilderness, they call it. So anyway, brothers and sisters, so we have the ark, which is shittim wood, which is corruptible flesh, human flesh. Jesus was a human flesh walking around, Son of Man, but yet also the Son of God, covered in gold. We are in our flesh. We got saved. Our heart became covered with gold. When we get to heaven, Paul says we take off when we get resurrected at the rapture. Now, people in heaven now, they're not in a corruptible body. They're in their spirit. They're in their gold-covered spirit walking on the streets of gold right now. But when the rapture happens, a.k.a. the resurrection of the saints, we will get our glorified body. We will get our, you know, symbolically, our gold body, our incorruptible body. John tells us when we see Jesus, we'll be like him. We'll have that incorruptible body that Jesus was walking around with after the resurrection. Walking around, he could eat, but yet you could put your hand in his side, and yet he could walk through the walls. You know, in another, let's say it in a secular way, in a scientific way, he was in a higher dimension. A higher dimensional being, just like angels. Why people can't see angels with their natural eye? They're in a higher frequency or a higher dimension. Demons are in a different dimension, higher dimension. They're there, but you can't see them with your natural eye unless God would give you the gift of discernment of spirits. And that is what the definition of the gift of discernment of spirits is, being able to see, hear, smell into the spirit realm, brothers and sisters, to detect the other side. To be able to detect heavenly realms or even demonic realms, either or both. That is discernment of spirits. Being able to sense the other side, brothers and sisters. You know, lots of people when they're about to die, especially old people who are Christians, you know, they'll see angels. I personally know several of my relatives who lived to be in their 90s, and I guess God honored them by letting them live into their 90s because they honored their mother and father. And they were Christians all their life, you know, since they were kids. And they were, you know, Christian people. And then they were old in their 90s. Every one of them I know, they knew when they were going to die. Several relatives I have, personally, who said, you know, as a matter of fact, one of my relatives, my mom's dad's mom, my great grandma, one of her children had died before her, and when he was in his 40s, and the day she died, she said, you know, this son, she named that son of hers and said, he's here to pick me up, pack my bags, he's here to pick me up. She said, I keep seeing white doves. I've been seeing white doves all day. And then this son of hers, he's here to pick me up and take me home. I need my bags packed. I'm leaving. You know, she talked about it all morning, and then she died in her sleep that afternoon when she took a nap. Had another relative, 95 years old. For 2 or 3 days, she kept telling me, I'm not afraid of dying. I'm not worried about it. I keep seeing angels. There's angels all around me. I keep seeing them. They're here with me. You know, and I'm not afraid to die. I know I'm going to die. I'm ready to go. Anytime it's up to God, hey. And this person was walking around perfectly, even though the person was 95 years old, this relative of mine. She was in perfect health for her age, living by herself, going along, and she told me that for 2 or 3 days. And then I had had a word from the Lord, watch out for a falling tall tree. You know, the Lord kept giving me that text from Daniel about a tall tree falling. You know, I didn't realize that, you know, that's a prophetic word. I don't know why I'm getting into this, but it's for somebody. But, you know, a tall tree represents, you know, long time, you know, a lot of influence. And just like Nebuchadnezzar was a giant in his, you know, his kingdom had far-reaching effects in the world. He was a tall tree with big branches. You know, so an old person, also you can see them, the older a tree, the taller it is. And then if they're a Christian, you know, the taller the tree, the more influence, the more it can be seen in the world. So the Lord had been telling me for a couple of days, watch out for a tall falling tree. I kept seeing it in a vision, hearing it from the Lord. And then this same 95-year-old relative of mine was telling me that she kept seeing angels. I didn't have enough sense to put two and two together until the person suddenly was gone. And I said, that's what the Lord was trying to tell me. Duh, you know. And so we learn from our lessons, brothers and sisters. We learn from God as He leads us by His Spirit. So where can I go with this as the Lord has led me to talk about those topics? You know, there's meanings to things, brothers and sisters. There's deeper meanings on and on and on. So I was talking about the Ark of the Covenant and talking about, you know, the grace. Is this what I wanted to talk about? I mentioned this before. I really want to get into this because it's the most important thing, brothers and sisters. On top of that ark, there's a covering on there, you know, and no one's supposed to lift it up. Like in the movie, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark, the Nazis tried to take that off, and then, you know, angels came out and killed them all. Angels of death killed those wicked Nazis in that, you know, fictional tale of them trying to find the ark in the Raiders of the Lost Ark movie. And back there from the 70s, the first one. And it's a good movie. And it's, you know, it kind of, you know, it shows that the ark is real, it's from God, and don't mess with it. I mean, that's the message of the movie. And I think that basic message is true, and people need to hear that. So it's good in that way. But anyway, brothers and sisters, that is meaningless to the video I'm making in the fact that the Bible says, Jesus said, the wrath of God abides on those who are not saved, who don't believe in Him. Now, that ark, on top of the ark is something called the mercy seat. I've talked about this before. And there's two angels on top. And it tells us in the Bible that Jesus, you know, He sits on that mercy seat. You know, He gives judgment. He will judge us from the mercy seat. So, brothers and sisters, when we look at that ark, we can see that inside the ark is 10 commandments. As an example, the Ten Commandments represents God's perfect standard. God's perfect standard. We can never reach that, brothers and sisters. The manna that's inside, there's a jar of manna in there, represents the provision of God. It represents the law and the provision of God. As I just said in the last video, I never heard anybody say that, but in the last video I was making, the Lord dropped it on me, that manna represented God providing in the wilderness. You know, the Bible says, and I've never heard this before either, and this is what the Lord was dropping on me. The Bible says that the law was a schoolmaster to bring us to the knowledge of sin and death. So the Israelites had that manna, that daily bread in the wilderness, until such time as they crossed over the River Jordan into the Promised Land. And the day they crossed over, the manna ceased. When they had crossed over into the Promised Land, which the Promised Land is symbolic of heaven, it's symbolic of the gospel. It's symbolic of resting in Christ. Hebrews chapter 3 and chapter 4, go read that. You will see that the Promised Land, the land of Israel, for us today means resting in the finished work of Christ, crossing over and resting in the finished work of Christ. Our Sabbath rest is by faith in Christ, the finished work of Christ. Not what we can do, not by keeping the law. Because the Bible says by the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. It's only through Christ. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Now, that mercy seat, the high priest would go in there and sprinkle blood on that thing once a year, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. Sprinkle some blood on there. Now, there's Christians trying to keep these holidays. But what does that represent? Jesus is our high priest who one time, it tells us all through Hebrews, one time Jesus went in. That high priest had to go in there every year. He had to make atonement for himself and then for the people. And then if he wasn't right with God, he'd fall over dead when he went in there. That's why they tied a rope around his waist. If he died, they could just pull him back out, you know. Just pull him back out under the veil if God struck him dead when he went in there because he wasn't righteous enough to go in there. Brothers and sisters, you can read in the traditions of the elders of Israel. You can, you know, read the details of how they did all that stuff and how the preparations that the high priest went through before he went in there, you know, and fasting and praying and sanctifying himself and baptizing and all this stuff to get prepared to go in there. That's, you know, written in the Hadith and all this stuff. You can read how they prepared themselves for that. And did I say the Hadith? I always get those extra biblical texts sometimes mixed up with the Muslim extra biblical, extra Quranic, excuse me, don't say extra Quranic text, because, you know, I studied that in school too. But anyway, these extra, maybe it's the Midrash, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I know Judaizers love that stuff. But those texts are meaningless other than just informational. You can see all the traditions, the oral traditions that were passed down of how they prepared the high priest and all those things before he would go in there. But anyway, brothers and sisters, Jesus, it says, only had to go in there one time. He offered his blood once, but not in the earthly ark. There's people that say, no. As a matter of fact, the ark was already hidden in that time. The ark wasn't in there at that time anyway. The ark had already been taken out back by Jeremiah and hidden. But anyway, brothers and sisters, Jesus, it says, he entered and put his blood on the ark in heaven. That's why, I should have said at the beginning of this video, because I said it in the last video, when God told Moses to make that ark and the tabernacle and all that stuff, he said, make it after the pattern I showed you in heaven. His things, you know, as Jesus said, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In everything we do, Jesus says, I do what I see my Father doing. See, we're supposed to pattern everything after the perfect standard, after what God's doing in heaven. That's why the devil's, you know, his motto is, as above, so below. What's done in the second heaven, where those principalities and forces of darkness are, let it be done on earth. You know, let's offer the, you know, abominable sacrifices of chickens and all this kind of voodoo and all that. Let's copy and do what we can to be an abomination to the third heaven by letting Satan lead us from the second heaven. Let's worship the sun, moon, and stars, those things in the second heaven. You know, worshiping the creation instead of the creator. That's why God gave them over to a reprobate mind. Romans chapter 1 talks about that. They worship the creation instead of the creator, making golden calves, worshiping the sun, the moon, the stars, all these things. All of those satanic and demonic things, brothers and sisters, people have done as they turn to the second heaven instead of to the third heaven, brothers and sisters. So, we see Jesus above that mercy seat. That mercy seat is also representing Christ as a propitiation. The King James says, He is shielding us from the wrath of God. The wrath of God is always coming down on sin, coming down on the world. God's wrath. But the things that are under the mercy seat, the wrath of God cannot hit those things because it's blocked, brothers and sisters, by the mercy seat, which is covered in the blood of Yeshua. The blood of Jesus is on top of that mercy seat, brothers and sisters. Just as the priest used to sprinkle it with the blood of bulls in the Old Testament, as a shadow of Jesus when he went, put his blood on the true ark that's in heaven, put blood on it. Therefore, God's wrath is satisfied. It's atoned for. It's an atonement cover, they call it. It's an atonement. It's blocking. The blood of Jesus is between me and the wrath of God. When God looks at me, he sees the blood of Jesus. I'm covered in the blood. If you're born again, we're covered by the blood. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible tells us we're redeemed from the curse of the law. Because Jesus became a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. And yes, a cross is a tree. A cross is a tree with the limbs cut off. You know, kind of shaped a little bit funny. But in the eyes of God, if you can see with what God sees, when you see a cross, you're looking at a tree, brothers and sisters. Look at the way God sees it. That's why I say there's so many people that are in the natural way of thinking instead of God's way of thinking. Open your mind, open your eyes, open your ears to hear what God, what the Spirit says to the church. Let your eyes be open that you may see what God is showing His church. It's right there in His Word, brothers and sisters. It's been before us the whole time. Let me just say this as I made that point. It is so hilarious, or so, not hilarious, it's just funny that like the Anabaptists, which are now, you know, came into what we call the modern day Baptists. It was so silly and so funny that they came along and said, hey, the Bible says that Jesus was submerged. He came up out of the water. You know, then the Spirit descended on Him like a dove. Paul said that we're buried with Christ in baptism and resurrected with Him. You know, and so God opened the eyes of those Anabaptists and they said, hey, baptism is by putting your whole body, laying down like you're dead and being put down under the water like you see. If you've ever seen anybody baptized, you know, in a Baptist church or in a Pentecostal church, you'll see them submerged in the water and come back up. Because that's what the Bible clearly says. But did you know from the time of the Dark Ages, where the devil joined and couldn't beat the church, so he joined it from Constantine through the Roman, Babylonian, demonic, satanic heresy until the time of the Reformation, all that time, all those things were lost, brothers and sisters, in the age of darkness, except for by the underground church, like the Waldensians and some of these other ones, John Huss down in Prague, and they're individuals. You know, and God began to restore His church. I know that I don't want to get off topic too much and go through church history, but anyway, those Anabaptists had their eyes opened by God and said, baptism is by submerging. And then all the traditional churches were, even the Lutherans and all them who had gotten the, you know, Martin Luther had got the revelation from God that the just shall live by faith. So, you know, salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone. You know, he got that revelation and was scorned by the Catholic Church. And then here's the Anabaptist saying, oh yeah, and you need, you know, when you're water baptized, it's you're submerged, emerged, submerged under the water, submerged under the water, not sprinkled on the head. The Bible doesn't say that. It clearly shows submersion. And then those old denominations, those old Protestants, is like, these are heretics, these are heretics. Still fighting what is in the obvious, plain, simple reading of the text. When God opens our ears to hear and eyes to see, we can see the text plainly exposed to us, brothers and sisters. That's why today God is continuing to restore His church. That's why I chuckle to myself when I hear denominational people saying, well, you know, I'm not into this new thing about, you know, speaking in tongues and all that. I'm part of the old school, the old church, you know, that old time religion where there's no speaking in tongues. You know, you typically hear this from your Baptist, the same group that brought us the truth from God that submerging in water was the way to go. And I laugh, brothers and sisters, because when I read the book of Acts, the original church and the real old-time religion, the real original church, the old-school church was Pentecostal. The first church was Pentecostal, not Catholic, no popes and all these fine vestments or vestures and outfits and all this pomp and circumstance and liturgies and all that stuff. They didn't have all those liturgies. Can you imagine those fishermen going around doing some liturgies and stuff, brothers and sisters? No, it was quickened. God spoke life into them. They spoke with fluid, moving life. Just as Jesus said, the Holy Spirit is like the wind. You can't see where it's coming or where it's going, but you can see the effects of it. Thus is the Holy Spirit. Jesus told us, John chapter 3, the breath of God. It's not contained in a box, as Paul told us. You know, the word of God can't be bound. And religion is the binding of God's word. The control by men. Can you imagine if the ark was just made out of shittim wood? How long would it last? Thank you, Lord, for tying it all together with the shittim wood. You know, religion, man-made religion is an ark made out of shittim wood with no gold over it. Let's put it that way. Might be another word, you know, shittim coated with something else, but it's not gold, brothers and sisters. It's the gold that's God's hand coming together with us, that shittim wood, and producing that ark. Praise God Almighty that the Bible said, Mary said that all generations would call her blessed. That the Blessed Virgin Mary said yes and was faithful to bring forth the seed of the woman, that God became a man. Praise God Almighty. God became a man, that we could also put on that incorruptible gold outer layer over our shittim wood, over our corruptible body. When we get to heaven, brothers and sisters, when the resurrection happens, the rapture, as it tells us, that the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Brothers and sisters, those dead people are coming back with the Lord. There's lots of other Bible verses that talk about it. What happens is those people that are died, they're in heaven now. They've got their gold-covered shittim heart, and they're in the spirit. They're in spirit form there with the Lord. And then when the rapture happens, they will come down, and they will come down and meet their body, whether their body, you know, their body will already be deteriorated, already turned back to dust. The Lord will resurrect their body. They will come back in their body, and then this time they will have a renewed body. Not a new body, but a renewed body. Shittim covered in gold, brothers and sisters, symbolically speaking. And we will take on our incorruptible body. We'll be caught up with them together to meet the Lord in the air. That is the rapture, brothers and sisters. The Latin word for caught up is rapiro, which is where we get the, in English, transliteration, rapture, brothers and sisters. God bless you all. May the peace of the Lord be with you, as I'll pray for you right now. Hallelujah, as the Spirit of the Lord says so. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Word of God says in Acts, God calls all men everywhere to repent and call on the name of the Lord Yeshua HaMashiach. Call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the Most High God. Hallelujah. And that's what I'm speaking to you from the Lord God Almighty. He calls you to repent. Repent. Turn from your wicked ways today and turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn your heart toward the Lord. Give your life to Jesus. Hallelujah. Give your life to Jesus. There's a guy that messaged me on one of my videos, and he said, I gave my life to Jesus, but I love to lie and steal. Will I still go into rapture? I said, if you keep lying and stealing, you didn't give your life to Jesus. You said the sinner's prayer. Saying the sinner's prayer is not what saves you. It's meaning it. Giving your life to Jesus means you go forth as a follower of Jesus, brothers and sisters. I've been through this many times and repeated it over and over again for those who don't have an ear to hear. Living in sin and sinning are two different things, brothers and sisters. We all sin, but people use it as a license to sin. When I begin to check their channel, those people that ask me those greasy grace questions, I'll check their channel and see that the videos that they like is heavy metal and all different kinds of world. Their whole channel is filled with worldly stuff, you know. And then they're on there trying to talk about, you know, I said a sinner's prayer and I'm going to heaven. You don't know what you're talking about. I can do whatever I want, still go to heaven. Brothers and sisters, don't bet your life. Don't challenge God. The Bible says, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not put thy Lord thy God to the test, Jesus tells us. Don't tempt the Lord and play with God, play chicken with salvation, brothers and sisters, because you're going to lose. You're going to lose. And if you, you know, that I'm not going to bet my soul on that. That's what I tell people. Well, I had this relative. They said a sinner's prayer. They said they're saved, but they lived real bad. And, you know, and I said, well, you know, brothers and sisters, the bottom line is we're not, God said, don't, Jesus said, judge not, lest you be judged. Amen. But quoting from the Word of God and by authority in the Word of God, brothers and sisters, you're supposed to deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow Jesus. Jesus said, any man that puts his hand to the plow and turns back is not worthy of me. Now, you want to try to figure out what that means? You want to bet what that means with your eternal destiny? Go for it. I always tell people when they ask me that question, well, what do you think about my, you know, my relative here? And he said a sinner's prayer and he's living like the devil. I said, well, you know what? I can't judge, but I don't want to be in his shoes. I wouldn't take the chance he's taking. I wouldn't play with God. I wouldn't tempt God. I wouldn't put God to the test. I'm not going to play in the fire. Hallelujah. I'm going to make sure. I'm going to see that my calling and election is sure, as the Bible says. I'm going to work out my salvation with fear and trembling. That's what the Bible says. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Hallelujah. The Bible also says, that I quote this all the time, Romans chapter 8, verse 14 and verse 16. Says, those that are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. If you're not led by the Spirit, you're not a child of God. God ain't leading you into living in sin. He's not leading you into doing that. So you're not being led by the Spirit. So how are you a child of God? What does it say after that? It says, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Are you? Is the Spirit of God bearing witness with you that you're His child? Are you going by what some preacher told you? You got to let His Spirit. Being saved is not making a mental agreement that, yeah, I believe Jesus is Christ. Yeah, Jesus died on the cross. Yeah, I believe that. That's not what getting saved is. His Spirit making you born again, you become spiritually born again, is an experience. It is a manifestation. It says, old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. You're supposed to become a new creature in Christ. Not just, oh, yeah, I believe the gospel. Just in your mind. As I quote all the time, mental assent is what John Wesley called it, founder of the Methodist. Yeah, you just say, yeah, I mentally agree that Jesus is a Christ. That's what these people are doing. It's called false converts. Yeah, I believe the gospel. Yeah, that's not being saved. It says when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, Jesus Christ is Lord. It's received by faith, but when you receive it by faith, there's a transformation. There is something that manifests in you, a literal, tangible, visible change in you. It's not saying a prayer and going back to what, I'd say 90% of the people I see, they hear this false gospel of saying a sinner's prayer, pushing people to say the sinner's prayer, instead of pushing people to give their life to Jesus. They push people to say a prayer. God wants to make you happy. God wants to make you blessed. That's not what the Bible says. The fruit of our salvation, the fruit of our relationship with the Lord is joy and peace and love and all that. That's the fruit after you're saved. God didn't save you to make you happy. He didn't save you to make you happy. He saved you because of His grace and mercy. We need Him. He don't need us. We need God. When you're saved and walking with the Lord, then we can bear fruit of the Spirit. As I just mentioned from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, you see love, joy, peace, temperance, which is self-control, all those kind of things. That comes from a result of our relationship. God is not here, to entertain us and make us happy. We're here to entertain Him, to bring glory to His name, to honor Him. Not for Him to honor us, but us to honor Him. When people got it backwards. They've been hearing that friendly, seeker-friendly, let's have the biggest church in the United States, let's have the biggest subscribers on YouTube message. Not the real gospel message. Hallelujah. Take up your cross and follow me. To carrying a cross doesn't sound like a good time. Jesus said, you know that they've hated me, they'll hate you also. No servant is above his master. You have tribulation in this life. When you follow Jesus, you will have tribulation. Not the tribulation. You will have tribulation in your life. You'll have enemies in your own household. You better go back and read the Bible and not listen to the seeker-friendly false gospel you've been hearing on television and the biggest churches. And, Joel Osteen, I'll just throw that one out there because he's, the easiest one for everyone to agree on. Extreme example, old Brokeback, Saddleback, Rick Warren and his Chris Lum. Brothers and sisters, I'm only can say what the Lord leads me to say. Praise God Almighty. Bless His holy name, brothers and sisters. Bless His holy name. You have to know in the spirit, brothers and sisters, when the Lord is leading you, you have to speak the way the Lord leading you to speak. It's not personal to me. Let me just add that on there because there's someone that told me, well, you're angry when you make your videos. No, I'm not angry. I'm being led by the Spirit. That's what God is. Angry with sin, not me. It's not a personal thing with me. I'm not personally responsible or involved if someone's saved or not. I'm just a messenger. Brothers and sisters, that's how the Spirit is leading me, to give His message in the spirit that God would have it given. Not like Joel Osteen. Well, shucks, I'm just a good old boy. Yeehaw! Largest church in America. Yeah, of course. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. That's right. Let's go hug a tree, man. God's going to give you that Cadillac. Now go hug a tree. Oh, yeah. All right, brothers and sisters. God bless all you guys. I love all you guys. And, hey, I hope that, I know I'm preaching to the choir lots of times. Hey, if you're already walking with God, of course it's not for you. And I have lots of people that message me all the time who got saved from watching my videos. And then there's people who watch my video and then they use what they heard me say to minister to other people. And that's what it's all about. You know, nobody's a one-man army. And I'm never claimed to be a one-man army. But I'm trying to disciple people who will then in turn be used by God. So praise God. That's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. We're a team. We're a team for the King. We're on the same team to bring glory to the Lord Jesus Christ and not to ourselves. God bless you guys.